Welcome back to my channel. Today is a two-part video. First of all, since we're getting closer to winter time and the colder weather, I wanted to go over what it takes to winterize a Model A, meaning put it away for the winter. Now, a couple of my Model A's get driven all year round. I don't have to do anything special with these. And some of my Model A's do get put away for the winter, for instance, the all-original 29 four-door. So I'm gonna show you what I do just to get this car ready for a little bit of a winter hibernation. And in the second part of this video, long-awaited, I've been asked, I don't know how many times, show us how to assemble a distributor. So I'm gonna do that. I'll go ahead and I'll do that in the house though. It's 29 degrees in the shop right now. So I'm gonna winterize this car. Then I'm gonna go to the house. I'm gonna show you how to assemble a distributor. And then just for fun at the end of this video, I'm gonna show you some of the wintertime projects my dad and I've got coming up. So anyway, welcome back to my channel and let's get started. Before we get going today, I'd like to thank two very special people who have donated to this channel, making these videos possible. Michael Eisenbeis, thank you so much for your donation. Also, Replications Company, thank you for your donation as well. It's special people like you that help make these videos happen, so thanks a bunch. Let's get back to the shop. The first thing you want to do before putting your Model A away for the winter is check and make sure there's no coolant leaks. Now that means open the hood, go around the block, look all around the head gasket, all the hoses, everything, make sure there's no leaks. If there aren't, then double check your coolant, make sure your coolant's still full, and that'll tell you of course too. There's two trains of thought on this. Some people believe that you should drain the coolant for winter, and that's fine. If that's your train of thought, just go to the driver's side, the petcock underneath the lower radiator hose, open it up, drain the coolant out, good to go. However, here in California, it never really gets that far below zero, so I don't really have to drain the coolants. I prefer to leave a coolant in, especially something with some rust prohibitive in it. So what I use is a 50-50 mix of distilled water and antifreeze, just regular old whatever's on sale over at the local auto store. So what I do is I mix this in the jug so it's ready to go. So my coolant is full, but if you're going to add some, drop your funnel in, take your pre-mixed 50-50 antifreeze and distilled water, top it off till it's just below the vent tube. You don't want to fill it up to where it overflows through the vent tube. Drain it, you're good to go. You might have to shake the car back and forth a little bit to see where your coolant level really is. But assuming you're using 50-50 and the coolant is full, your system should be in good shape when spring comes. The next thing I do is I head under the car, top off all the fluids, the rear end, transmission, all that, check the engine oil. And then one more really important thing, and you're gonna laugh at this, but you hear me all the time in videos talking about before you take your Model A anywhere, be sure to lube the distributor. Well, why am I doing this now before putting away for winter? Well, there is logic to this. Just hear me out for a second. So assuming something happens to me over the winter, I don't know, let's say I eat myself to death at Thanksgiving or Christmas or something, or who knows, what else could happen? But either way, so springtime comes around, my grieving widow now needs to sell my Model A's, and you know what's going to happen? Some knucklehead with a checkbook is going to show up and chuckle his way into buying one of my Model A's. He's going to expect to jump in it, start it up, and drive it home. So I know they're not going to lube the distributor. I'm just thinking ahead. I don't know. I always try to think ahead. Anyway, I'll just do this and get it over with. You can make fun of me all you want. Now the first part's easy. Pop the distributor cap off. This one fits tight. It's an original. Pop the rotor out. Take your tube of super lube. I'll put a link to this down in the description below, by the way, where you can buy this on Amazon. Put some on your pre-greased finger here. Rub it on the distributor cam, which you can't see. That's it. You're good to go. Rotor back on. Get the rotor, there it goes. Cap back on, snap, done. Second part, take your synthetic motor oil with the oiler, drop it in, fill it up, let it go, done. See how easy that was? Now the next thing I do before putting the Model A away for the winter is put a coat of wax on it. You're like, Paul, have you been running your Model A's in the garage without ventilation again? No, 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 really, hear me out on this. So I clean the car off real well, then I put a coat of wax on it. Couple things. Number one, I want to make sure that just in case any moisture or anything gets in the car or on the car's finish, I don't want it eating through the little micro cracks, the moisture getting down under the paint, getting into the metal, causing any rust. Mainly, it makes it really easy to dust off in the spring. But of course, springtime, I'm gonna put a coat of wax on it then too. So two things. Number one, the cleaning product I use, Dry Wash and Guard, you've heard me talk about this before. I'll put a link in the description. And then the wax I use is this 303 spray wax. I don't know, I really like this stuff. Just spray on, wipe off, it's really fast. You'll see what I mean here in a minute on the time lapse. I'll put a link to this in the description too, so you can just pick this up on Amazon. Now after you've cleaned and waxed both sides of the car, the next step is the top and the tires, and I use this. And yes, I will link to this in the description below. You can pick this up on Amazon too. This stuff works really good. And that is how I keep this 92-year-old original paint looking like this. A lot of people think this car's been repainted. It hasn't. Go look at some of the other videos on this car and you'll see what I'm talking about. Well, sure I'm gonna miss this car for a few months, but it's time to take it out on the road for one last drive before I put her away. Now, after pulling your Model A into the garage for what is going to be a long winter's nap, be sure and just shut the gas valve off. Let the motor run until it runs all the gas out of the carburetor. Don't turn the ignition off. Let it drain the carburetor as much as possible. When you're done with that, shut it off. Go out and hopefully you have one of those starter mounted fuse holders. Pull the fuse out to disconnect the battery from the car. And if you don't have one, go ahead and just disconnect the battery itself. Don't set the parking brake, by the way. If you set the parking brake, what can happen is the brake lining can weld itself to the brake drum after it sits for a long time. Instead, just get a good old-fashioned rock, put these in front of and behind the wheels, and while you're at it, if you have one of these fancy 6-volt trickle chargers, connect this to the battery. Should be good to go, up and ready. It's springtime when you go to take the car out the next time. Gonna miss you. All right, let's go inside and let's put together a distributor. Welcome inside my home where it's nice and warm. So what we're gonna do now is assemble a distributor. We've already done videos on how to restore a distributor. We're going to assemble one today. So if you look at the restoration video, you'll see how to clean the casting, make sure that the casting is ready to accept all the new guts, how to install new bushings and ream those, and then how to install a shaft and all that. So I won't go over that again. All I'm gonna do today is show you how to assemble a distributor. So I'm starting off with this distributor. I rebuilt this for a club member, let's call it 7 years ago, and it worked great, and then he made some modifications and it quit working. So he sent it back to me, and I'm going to put it back to mostly original. The only thing he insists on, he wants those modern V8 style points instead of stock points. I'm like, yeah, okay, fine. That's one modification I'll kind of go along with. So anyway, I'm gonna do it with a non-drilled shaft. So this is gonna be a original shaft. Now the difference is on the drilled shafts, it's called, you'll find a little hole in the shaft. And what that hole does, it's connected to a hole in the top of the shaft. And if you have one of these fancy screws that has a hole in it, like so, and you look down inside there, I don't know if you can see it real well, but that hole inside goes out to that hole on the side. So if you put oil inside this, it drips down inside the shaft, comes out that hole, lubes the upper bushing. However, I have never found a stock distributor, this one is not drilled, that has a worn upper bushing but an okay lower bushing. For whatever reason, the upper bushing tends to get lubricated just fine. Doesn't really matter. So I tend to run the stock setups. A couple of my cars have the drilled shaft just because that was what was available. So anyway, so there's two different screws. Obviously there's the screw I showed you that has a hole in it, and then there's the stock screw that does not have a hole. So we're gonna be using mostly stock things today. So assuming you put your shaft in and then you put the keeper in and all that, the main thing is to make sure that there isn't wear on that, because you want the short shaft that goes into this to be able to couple it real well and not have a lot of play in it. Now this can have a little bit of in play back and forth. That means this way. And I don't remember what the tolerance is. It's not much. But the fact is, when you put this in the car and you have the rotor and everything on it, the spring clip on top of the rotor is going to be pushing down on this all the time. So this in play really doesn't matter as much as people think. But that's about what you want right there. Just enough to where it's free and loose and there's no binding, but not so much that you can really move it back and forth. And I don't know what that tolerance is, but it's not a whole lot. If for some reason your shaft has too much in play, then what you need is these little thin washers right here. You just add some of those in and get rid of the in play. The first thing we're going to do with a nice clean installation here, a nice clean housing, is we're going to pick our lower plate. Now there's a couple things. So this is an original lower plate. You notice it has this cotton covered wire that's real flexible. And this is kind of bent. If you look close, this is bent back a little bit. So here's what happens. A lot of people, when they go to this condenser and don't have this condenser, the kind that goes in the distributor body like so, and then they have this lower plate like this. What happens with this lower plate is where the ignition cable screws in right here, like this, where that screws in, it pushes against the tab in the lower plate. That tab's right here. It pushes against this and makes that connection. If you don't have the stock condenser in, which gives this rigidity, it bends this. So everybody goes to this condenser, puts it on the upper plate, and that's like a modification, supposed to be better. It's not better, it's worse. So they say, well, don't screw the ignition cable in so far and then it won't short out. You know what? You should be able to screw that all the way down tight. If you have the correct condenser installed, it won't short out. So that condenser being in there like that is what holds that tab and keeps it rigid. So that's why if somebody's distributor is shorted, that's why it happened. So this is a modification somebody made that had this distributor. This is the lower plate I installed. I know because it's got my wire on it. But they glued this piece of insulator on here so that without that condenser installed, with that condenser on the upper plate, that's what kept it from shorting out. The problem is the shaft was rubbing on this. That's not the way to fix it. So anyway, that is garbage. So what I've done is I've made a new lower plate. This is an original lower plate that I have refurbished and gotten it ready for them. I cleaned up the contact point where the ignition cable plugs in and also where the condenser is going to go, and I put a new wire on it. Now, the wire that I use is very, very flexible. It's hundreds of strands of wire. And the reason I use this is because you keep in mind that wire flexes back and forth every time you move your ignition timing lever. So the wire I use is 100 strands of very fine copper wire. It's very flexible. It's called hookup wire. This is a high temperature version of hookup wire. So what I do is I just make a whole bunch of these and have them ready to go. So when I have to rebuild the distributor, I just reach in the bag and grab one. So I soldered that onto the lower plate here. You see the center is soldered there. And then this is just crimped around the insulation. And just for good measure, I put a little piece of heat shrink there on the lug. Okay, so that's out of the way. So assembling this, you notice there's only two screws that hold the lower plate on and two screw holes in the housing. So keeping that in mind, now I got to go to Cheaters. Line those up, get your screws, make sure to use lock washers. You may have saw in the video we did on how to restore distributors, we were making fun of somebody for not using lock washers and their lower plate came undone. That was very unfortunate. So I'll get this down with the lock washers. All right, now you don't have to like over tighten this, but you want it pretty snug. All right, lower plate installed. Okay, next step, you gotta get your spring. That just goes like that, super simple. The trick is your upper plate needs a ground connection because your points are constantly grounding against the points block. So that needs a ground connection from the upper plate to the distributor housing. Two places it gets that ground. One is the tabs that slide in and out of those channels. It gets grounding there. It also gets grounding through this spring. So make sure your spring is nice and clean. That has to make good contact to the lower plate. And that's how you get grounded. So now I got to connect this to the points. It's very simple. Take this hardware off here. I'll put my wire on, and the wire has to go through this slot right here in the upper plate. So I put that on. I might have to do this off camera. Might need more hands than this. Set this down here. Sorry, I'm not doing this on camera, but I'll show you here in just a second. There we go. Need that. It does not have to be overly tight. Don't torque this. Just get it tight to where it doesn't fall off or back out. You should have a little lock washer on it. That's it. That's all it takes, literally. Okay, so there you go. Now the next step is you got to wind the wire around. I'm talking like Elmer Fudd here. So if you imagine with this mounted in the car, if you were on the passenger side looking in at the engine compartment, you're going to see the oiler here, okay, and that's going to face kind of towards the door handle of the passenger door. So this has to point straight back in that case. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to find the spot. I'm going to wind the wire around and find the spot to where I can get the tabs into slots, push down. There we go. That's all there is to it. So as you can see, I've already put the modern points on the upper plate. I don't think I need to show you how to mount points. It's pretty self-explanatory. I'm not a big fan of the modern points, but that's what this particular club member wants. So in the previous video, we talked about polishing the distributor cam, how important that is. When a distributor cam comes, this is a brand new one I just bought, a Stipe distributor cam. Real pretty, right? Very expensive too, but not very smooth. So I've taken this cam and I've polished it with my Dremel tool, and as you can see, it's mirror finish. It's absolutely, even with a magnifying glass, no pitting, nothing. It's perfectly silky smooth. That's what you want. So just install that here. Okay, now in this case, not a drilled shaft, so I'm using a regular screw. First thing I'm going to do here at this point, I'm going to get this kind of snug down. It helps sometimes to take a distributor timing tool to hold the cam while you tighten it, in case the screw's kind of tight in there. Like that. Just want a little tight. Now what I'm going to do is put my cheaters back on. And I'm going to check the points gap. This is where you set the points gap. Don't do it in the car. Do it now. This is what you want. So I've got my feeler gauge out. I want 18 thousandths. That's right there. Yeah, you can kind of see it, 18 thousandths. So I'm going to measure this gap right here. The gap's a little bit big. Measure all four lobes. See if they're the same. That one's big too. That one looks a little big. These all have to be exactly the same. You do this when you're preparing your distributor cam is the time to do this. So now, as you can see, the other reason I don't like this, this has Phillips head screws. And of course, I didn't bring Phillips head screwdriver in here because I'm working on a Model A. I only need standard. So I got to go out to the shop in the cold and get a Phillips head screwdriver. I'll be right back. And now with a Phillips head screwdriver, now I can loosen this up and I can adjust the points gap. This is so touchy to do, whereas if you have the stock points, it's really simple. But with it sitting on top of one of the lobes, I'm just going to kind of eyeball this now. You're supposed to be able to put a screwdriver in this slot and adjust it, but you know what? That doesn't really work. All right, that looks about right. I've got a guess at it. There we go, I'll tighten that up. Okay, now I'll measure this again. There we go, 0.18. Oh, look at that. Perfect. All right, this one. Perfect. Next one. Perfect. And the fourth. Perfect. All right, that is good to go. This distributor is set. Now all we got to do is install the condenser. So what I do first is slide the condenser in. And the main thing I want to do is I want to get that screw in the very end. I want to do that first. The way to tell if your capacitor or condenser is good or not is using a capacitor meter. You're going for somewhere between 0.2 and 0.25 microfarads. This one is 0.237 microfarads. That's perfect. This so-called modern condenser is 0.204, just barely okay, but usable. Main thing is to make sure there's no shorts. Time to get that condenser installed. The instructions call for a fiber washer at the end of the screw that goes into the condenser. The problem with that is you're trying to make an electrical contact on the end of that conductor right there. So I don't use the fiber washer. I use a small lock washer instead. Okay, yeah, it's not original, sorry. But then again, I don't have condensers that don't make contact either. So the first thing you got to do is take the screw, get it in that hole right there. If you can, carefully. Right there. Screw is in the hole. Now, hold that with your finger. Put the condenser in. Tighten it down. And don't get it super tight yet. You'll notice the condenser tab doesn't sit exactly against the distributor body. That's okay. This has to ground, so if you haven't already, clean the paint from around that hole where the screw goes in. Make sure that you scrape the paint off around that screw where that tab goes in, because it has to make good contact to the distributor body. So now I'm going to take my screw with a little washer, install that one. So once this one's tight, this has to be tight first. Okay, and that one's good and tight. It's pushing on the tab. Now I'll go ahead and I'll tighten this screw at the end, but not super tight because you don't want to break. All right, there it is. One distributor ready to go. Yeah, I need to put the tabs on. So it just so happens I have a brand new set of tabs here. That's two sets of spring tabs and two rivets. This is going in a 29, so using these. So very simple, make sure that that points inward. Now, as far as the tabs facing forward or backwards, I've seen it both ways, but I always make them face backwards. Just because my original 29, the distributor in that, they face backwards, so I don't know, maybe that's how they came from the factory. Yeah, sounds good to me, so that's just how I do it. All right, start with a screwdriver in between those. Just kind of pry them apart, get it started. Now I take my pliers, move them like that, go over here, and I'll bend them all the way like that. Good to go. Same thing on this one. Make sure you install it this way, not this way, this way. Screwdriver in, started. There you go, all done. They all point the right way. All right, life is good. That is how you assemble a distributor. Go slap it in the car, time it, send you on your way. Oh, real quick, before I sign off today, I wanted to show you some of the projects we've got coming up this winter. So let's cruise out to my old man's shop and I'll show you some of the stuff we've got in the queue. Here's some of the stuff we've been working on in the shop and some of the stuff we're going to be working on this winter. Number one, we're putting together motors. And it's a good thing because what have we been doing? Buying new Model A's.
This new acquisition of ours back there.
Oh, that fella is following us real close.
Yeah, that guy in the Model A is right on my butt. Another Model A.
It's a good thing we've got a few motors ready to go because guess what? Right after we bought that Model A, we went and bought another one. So this is what I've been doing and this is what he's been doing. But this Model A had a frozen motor in it, so first thing we had to do was get one of the fresh rebuilds out and install it. Of course, that's just one of the many projects we have going on all at once. It seems like there's just a ton of stuff to do all the time. So as soon as we got the motor in this car, we had to start working on some of the other stuff again that was a little bit more of a priority, like this one, which needed a new radiator. And we just about got that done. And then, of course, there's this coupe, which you just saw me putting a motor in this. We just have to finish the motor installation on that. But it shouldn't take too long. The good news is this car right here is now running and driving fantastic. It's got a little bit of electrical work, and as far as this one goes, I don't know, don't even ask. At least I got new wood put in this one. Then there's this slant window, late 31. Not quite sure what we're gonna do with this one. Maybe just leave it as is and just get it running again. Kind of looks cool, but I don't know. We might end up doing a restoration on that.
And there's the truck. Yeah, it's a truck kit.
You're probably gonna laugh at this, but believe it or not, this four door is probably the most done car we have. This chassis's got new motor, new transmission, brakes, new Mitchell overdrive, everything. It's ready to go. We just took the body off, sent it out to have it redone. When it comes back, we'll paint it, put it back together. This car's good to go. Anyway, thanks again so much for watching, and thank you again to those who donated. I'll put a link down below to the PayPal donation. I appreciate that very much. Still working on a sponsor. If you are a Model A part supplier, I would love to partner with you. Please hit me up, Paul at paulshin.us. We can do so much together. If we had a sponsor, we could do the parts part of it, and I can do the video and maintenance part of it. And I've got lots of club members who'd love to have the stuff done on their car, so we could do a lot more videos. Anyway, thank you so much. Now, this time of year, we're so thankful. Thank you to you for subscribing to my channel. If you haven't done so yet, click the subscribe button, please. It's free. And also, karma will take note. And if you subscribe to my channel, your Model A won't break down on the next tour. Thank you very much. And if I don't see you before then, a happy Thanksgiving to you and a Merry Christmas to you as well. See you in the next video.